Fantastic. So, theme one, which is the economic history theme, has done amazing work on producing new data. So not just using existing data, but making data accessible to researchers worldwide. And we've seen a lot of that in what Steve talked about, that data is, on the one hand, national GDP figures and a lot of other macro variables, but also Steve has been heavily involved with a lot of CAGE members in producing regional estimates from across Europe. So we also can now see more clearly within countries the ones that are lagging behind today may have been lagging behind for 100 years, or they may have lost out. And all this is now possible with new data produced. We also have a database specifically for the economic history of Prussia, one part of the German Empire, and also that is accessible and has been used by hundreds of researchers around the world. So CAGE has been able in these 10 years to produce a lot of data and makes it available to researchers all around the world. So who are the people in CAGE? What I've done here is, with the help of our PhD student, Anthony Tuckwell in the back, is just to take all CAGE working papers in theme one only. So that's only about economic history. And it just highlights by the size of the letters the most prolific writers at CAGE. And I guessed beforehand that there may be one name in the center. And without having to treat the data too much, that name is in the center. And one of the reasons is Nick Crafts wrote working paper number one and ever since hasn't stopped writing at least 3 or 4 a year. So that is this. So what I did also is, and I should have done that much earlier, but now taking this retrospective of 10 years, just to get a sense of what territory have we covered in our research under theme one. And a lot of it is obviously on the UK, on the British Isles, and that's both Britain and Ireland. And there is lots of researchers in-house, but also external researchers, because CAGE on one end is the people locally here at Warwick, and then famous researchers from around the world, many of them here in the room. We've done a lot of work and are still doing a lot of work on China, India, and Japan, but also on Africa and on the US. And then we have some specialties as well on parts of Europe, on Germany, on Eastern Europe, and then with various external research fellows, we cover a lot of other countries and areas of the world. So really, literally, except maybe Australia, we cover all continents of this planet.
And that's why you're going there, Sasha.
Yeah, need to collect some data. So then using the same database of 163 working papers that were written with an economic history focus, we highlight the salient topics. And again, maybe you're not surprised that economic growth stands out, that there is the 1930s, that is again a Nick Crafts effect, and then there is China, there is evidence, there is perspective, there is long run, human capital, and so on. So that is the coverage of topics we have. We've been successful at publishing. This is again only drawing on the working papers that were written in the last 10 years and that have already made it into publication. And for those who are not economists in the room, getting a paper published in economics is pure madness. Yeah? I had a paper published this year where the first version was written 10 years ago. Yeah? It's madness. So that list has a lot of economic history journals, but also what we consider top 5 journals, American Economic Review, Quarterly Journal of Economics. So we've been successful at getting this stuff out. Yeah? Now, I would like to highlight just 5 papers or 5 research highlights from the last 5 years only, one per year, and say just a few words about them. The first is, again, turning to the work of Steve and co-authors on British economic growth over 600 years, which also builds on that data set that you assembled. So it's here described as the definitive new account of Britain's economic evolution from a backwater of Europe to the hub of a global economy. And that data, I want to highlight this because, given that there also are ESRC people in the room, it needs the ESRC and funding bodies like the ESRC to do this stuff. It takes time. Yeah? So this whole project on putting together GDP figures for the UK and for the world has taken 10 years. Yeah? So you can't do it just with a little grant for 1 year. You need a long-run environment where you can do it. So that data is now available on the website of the Bank of England and also on the Madison website in Groningen with the updates of the Madison database. Here I'm just picking one paper from the year after, 2016, by two of our research fellows who are based in Ireland. And they look at something that Adam Smith, the godfather of economics, said 200 years ago. He claimed that over the 18th century, prices for watches fell by 95%. Well, Adam Smith said it, so it must be right. But really, no one had ever put it to hard data. So what do these guys do? They collected data, and that's a smart idea. Economic historians are, as some people say, they are detectives. They go and search and dig. Yeah? So they had this idea to go to court records of the Old Bailey and just try to see what was the value of watches stolen from people. Okay? And then you can see in that chart that the value of watches over that century just falls by 80 to 90%. Yeah? So Adam Smith was right, but now we know it based on hard facts. So then another piece of research that nicely shows what Cage does, and also this I know for a fact, is a paper that Luigi Pascali worked on for 6 or 7 years, just putting together data from around the world. It's called The Wind of Change. And what it's about is that until 200 years ago, ships would only cross the oceans by sail. Then the steamship came along. So what does that do to trade? So here, that picture illustrates it. So as you still have the sailing ship, you can only travel as the wind goes. And that means if you're on your way from the UK to Asia, you travel down this way, you would typically go from the west coast of Africa, stop over in Brazil, and then continue on via South Africa to India or other places in South Asia. On the way back, the wind takes you this way. You stay along the African coast. Okay? Oh, wrong direction. Boy, what am I doing? Okay. And now that the steamboat comes along, wind no longer matters. So now Brazil is cut off. No one going to India needs to stop over in Brazil. And suddenly, Brazil loses out in worldwide perspective. And other countries lose out as well, and other regions gain. So there is a rebalancing of who are leading economies, simply because the steamship comes along. Okay, so that's fascinating stuff that took years of work to put together. Then this is another long-term project that Cage was involved in via Mark Harrison. And it's about the industrialization of the Soviet Union from 1929 to 1939. And the last volume of a 7-volume edition came out last year, 2018, and it completes this authoritative account of the Soviet Union's industrial transformation. And I was at the launch event, and also I want to highlight this, it's not a typo. This ran over 45 years. This whole project, and was funded originally by the predecessor of the ESRC, the SSRC, and there was funding again and again and again. No researcher would have that funding by themselves. Having like ESRC funding and so on is super important to be able to do this. And here you see Mark Harrison, our colleague, and the gentleman on this handheld device is the godfather of the whole project, who is now 94. And who signed off on this latest edition, and now his lifetime work is finally completed. So then another piece of research, and here a bit of self-promotion, another paper of Luigi Pascalis and myself that just came out 4 weeks ago in the American Economic Review, looks at anti-Semitism over many centuries. And here our starting point is to say, okay, let's look at cities that had Jewish communities in the German lands. And this particular graph is for the century 1300 to 1400. That's when the Black Death took place and when Jews were blamed to have caused the Black Death. And then people would persecute Jews. So any of these dots on the map is a Jewish community in Germany in this century. And the black dots are the ones where Jews get killed or get pushed out of the city, okay? And the colors in the background tell you whether a territory after the Reformation became Protestant or remained Catholic. And the red areas are the ones that become Protestant. The blue ones are continuously Catholic. And what we do here is to say, well, the Reformation brought in a new flavor of Christianity. Catholics had carved out a market niche for Jews to be in money lending. Protestants were more economy friendly and allowed also Christians to lend money at interest, which Catholics wouldn't allow their own people, but would allow the Jews. So Protestants would start competing with Jews in money lending. Okay? And that may lead to a shift in where Jews reside and also how much Jews are appreciated as neighbors. So what we look at and show is that while before the Reformation, and the Reformation century is this one, there is no substantive difference between areas that remain Catholic throughout and those that become Protestant at some point. With the Reformation, there is an increase in anti-Semitism in Protestant areas, and then that gap closes at some point, at least in terms of actual persecutions and killings. But we show in various other ways, text analysis, anti-Semitism in books, voting for anti-Semitic parties in the 19th century, that there carries on to be the difference between Protestant and Catholic areas in the degree of anti-Semitism. And then political science research shows that Hitler came to power not least by votes in Protestant areas. Okay? So there is a pattern that carries on over quite a long time. So turning to policy, what is Cage's unique selling point? Cage does history. And as far as I'm aware, no other ESRC center does economic history. So that is our main thing. But Cage generally connects economic history with neighboring things. Yeah? So we do economic history and well-being, looking at books over 400 years to see well-being in literature, and so on. So how do we communicate our findings? And here I'm talking more generally, not just theme one. There are Cage policy reports, Cage policy briefing papers. We write VoxEU columns, newspaper columns, work in government commissions, giving expert evidence, House of Commons, House of Lords, Welsh Assembly, European Commission, etc. We have events like this in London, Warwick, Brussels, and so on. And here are just some examples of the work we do that had policy impact. Nick Kraft says, had this book some years ago with Peter Fearon that is explicitly about the Great Depression, so about the 1930s, and tries to draw lessons for today. What errors were made back then, and what can we do better today? And that had quite some policy impact, and Nick Kraft, even nowadays, every few weeks gives talks in London again and again in ministries and talks about exactly these things. Nick was also part of a commission on the future of manufacturing. We have a deep belief that economic history can teach us stuff. Yeah? And in the same way that today people are worried, oh, robots take over and we will be jobless, people said the same thing 200 years ago when the first machines came along and textile workers lost their jobs. It's not new. So about the financial crisis and the subsequent years, a lot of work has been done here at Cage. The financial crisis has been represented by the OECD as good because crises bring reforms. But Nick Crafts already some years ago warned that that view is too positive because crises also bring political reactions. And we've seen that. Our fellow economic historian Kevin O'Rourke wrote that the backlash against financial crisis was many years coming. So is history repeating itself? Well, yes, maybe. So we've done a lot of work on Brexit, on explaining the Brexit vote. One paper we wrote very early on is the most downloaded paper at the Economic Policy Journal. There is the work that Andrew Oswald talked about earlier today about whether older people or are the ones who voted for Brexit, whether it's about income or perceptions about income. There is more and more, and my colleague Timo Fetzer just this month got a paper accepted that also will go in the American Economic Review that says that austerity is a key factor behind the Brexit vote. People started to vote for UKIP in the minute that their own benefits, welfare benefits, were cut. They wanted to blame someone and they voted for a party that told them that it's all about the EU. So there is more going on and I expect much more work to come out of Cage that looks at Brexit. Cage also runs lots of high-profile conferences that may be more on the academic side, but also always have a policy angle. So one that's coming up, and that's a bit of advertisement for the next year, we will have a CAGE British Academy conference in May next year at the British Academy in downtown London. That will be about technology and the future of labor, historical and contemporary perspectives. And that will bring together top-notch academics from around the world. And we have got Andy Haldane to sign up and give a talk, and there will also be a policy panel. And we had similar events earlier on, one that Sharoon Mukant arranged, that had Paul Romer as one of the speakers, who then just 1 or 2 years later went on to become a Nobel Prize winner. And what I'm also highlighting here is what I said in passing, that this was an event that kind of was a crossover between theme one, economic history, and theme two, long run development, culture, institutions, which is theme two that we'll hear about in the next session. And here I may have highlighted that this work on Brexit, on the one hand, is political economy, so that's what Vera's theme has been working on. It's about happiness. People who are pissed off vote maybe extreme parties, so it's about well-being, so it's theme three. But it's also economic history in the sense that, well, populism is not a new phenomenon. We just had forgotten about it, yeah? But it's there and will come back again and again. And this was theme one meets theme two. So CAGE has managed in these 10 years to always connect these four themes. And that's why CAGE is more than the sum of its parts, OK? So the final word is CAGE is there for the long run. Yeah, so I hope for another 50 years. Let me stop here.